all of you would be knowing about Aryabhatta, Brahmagupta, and several others. Their astronomy is called Siddhantic astronomy, that is the mathematical astronomy. That started somewhere around 100 AD or so. What was the kind of astronomy that was there in our country before Alexander? You put that question. This becomes important because there is a theory that Siddhantic astronomers got their planetary numbers from the Greeks. Is that true or not? We have to verify. But as a preliminary, we have to know what our people were thinking in the most ancient time, that is during Buddha's time, during Mahavira's time, which was around 500 or 600 BC, and even earlier to that. So I'm taking you in this talk briefly. It's a bird's eye view of some of the Vedic texts and what do they give, what kind of information is available in that. I will not be going into the philosophy of Vedic texts, nor on the serious interpretations of Sayana and others, even though I would refer to some of them. But one thing we have to keep in our mind. In the most ancient period, particularly during the Vedic period, the Vedic seers, they were in some kind of unison or unity between earth and the sky. Dyauh Pita Mata Prithivi Mata, that was their concept. So in the night times, they didn't have the kind of city lights that we are having now. And even now, if you see, look at the sky from in a dark place, maybe from the Himalayas, particularly in the winter, you will see that a wonderful view of the sky with the stars, the planets, so many things hanging like lights. So it gives a feeling that we are one with them. That is the kind of feeling that our ancients had during the Vedic period with the universe, particularly the sky. So the sky and the earth was same. You just imagine, earth is just a planet in the space. That means we are all flying on a space shuttle. You can think like that. And the whatever they saw, they sung about that. And we have large number of hymns. Later on, of course, there are several texts and also the Puranas, which discuss some of these legends in their own way. In other words, the Vedic information that was there, it became something like a story, something like a legend. I won't call them myth. Myth means mithya, that is false. They were not false. They were forgotten or they were transformed into folklore and in some other form. Now, many of you would be knowing some of the things which I have listed. I hope all of you are able to see the screen. The legend of Dhruva.
Sir, just a minute.
Yes.
The slide is visible. This is Sudarshan again. If any of you have access to a PC, that would be a better experience than logging in through a smartphone. But if you don't have it, we'll continue it. You can continue to do so. Sir, while you proceed, sir, how is this different from the Jyotisha that we come across in our day-to-day life? If you can repeat that again.
Shall I proceed?
Please go ahead.
Okay. You would see the legend of Dhruva, all of you would have heard. Then legend of gods drinking Soma, that is Somapana. This also you would have heard. Actually, this legend is connected with the eclipses, the lunar eclipse period, number 3339 of the Rig Veda. Then there are several other legends which are connected with the precession of Earth. You know that the Earth rotates and on a long period of about 26,000 years, there is a full circle which is done. That is the ecliptic pole and the celestial pole. We'll come to it later. And we have several legends associated with Nahusha, Saptarshi, Agastya, which are all connected with the precession. There is also some peculiar transient celestial objects, as they are called. For example, there is reference to Shakadhuma, who is considered a demon later on in some of the Puranas. Actually, this is an object between stars Kritika and Rohini. And there are a large number of comets which are mentioned in the Rig Veda and also in the later texts. There is the Dhumaketu. It is the celestial fire. Celestial fire is going to be either a meteorite or a supernova or a comet. Also, in the Vedas, we find a large number of references to Earth, that is the Prithvi, Antariksha, and Dyauh, that is sky, and the anomalies related to them. And they are, if everything is normal, there is going to be a peaceful life on Earth. That is what it says. If there is an anomaly, what is going to happen? They become the portents, or the Shakuna, as it was called in the olden times. And that is how the astrology and other things started to interpret abnormalities in the sky as affecting the Earth. In some sense, it is true. In some sense, it may not be totally valid. Then, you know, after the Vedic period, we come to a text called Parashara Tantra, which is available only in quotations right now. The original manuscript, you have not been able to locate it. But from what others have written, that is actually quoted Parashara, we know that Parashara knew a solar zodiac of six seasons, and he knew about 26 comets with the number of years in between their appearance. And in fact, this totally adds to about 1,300 years. Now, how did they know it? Only his predecessors should have recorded and left that record for Parashara to tell that to his students, who passed on that information, like the Vedic information. It is a oral text. And somewhere in the 3rd century or the 4th century, somebody wrote it down. There are also many others, like, you know, Garga is a very well-known name, like Parashara. And this is all finally, you know, comes into the Puranas. So the Brahmanda, Vishnu, there are several other Puranas. They all discuss the principle behind the Somapana. Or what is meant by Soma being drunk by gods? That is the question. And Brahmanda Purana discusses also the Dhruva. These are all I am showing you because they come from the Vedic context only. Now, Puranas, it is said, they are valid for the, I mean, they were written down in the period 100 to 400 AD. That is the Gupta period. Because there was no writing before Ashoka, we don't know. Inscriptions, no inscriptions has been found out. No texts are available. But these also contain astronomical statements. And if you see the dating of the astronomical statements, they could not have occurred during 100 to 400 AD at all. I will come to that. I will show you the evidence for that. But they would be valid for about 1500 BC. That means somebody observed this in a very ancient time, and that has been carried over and written somewhere in 100 to 400 AD. Now, if you go to the Vedic text, what are the ways that we have to understand the Vedic text? Just one or two slides on this. Whatever I'm going to present to you is only traditional. You know that Sanskrit text can be interpreted in slightly different ways, and you know one can make different meanings out of some of the mantras and other things. That is how the difference of opinion has come. But I am following only the standard tradition of Vedic texts, that is coming through Nirukta of Yaska. He lived somewhere around 1000 BC, you know, 700 to 1000 BC. He says there are three meanings to the Rigvedic hymns. The same thing applies to the other Vedas also, to some extent. What are they? One is really called Adi Yajna meaning. This is connected with the sacrifices. The second one is the Adi Daiva, that is related with the celestials. Celestials, we should not think of them in this context as gods, whom we worship, of course, now, not in that sense. They had a form, that is the stars, the nakshatras, the planets, and whatever was visible. That is the Daiva as Divya, coming from the Sanskrit Dhatu, Div. So that is something which is bright and shining. Then the third one is Adhyatma, the mystical meaning. These are the three meanings. I will give one example to proceed further. What is Soma? Soma has three meanings in the Vedas. In the Adidaiva meaning, it is the moon. You can see the Shatapatha Brahmana, in one of the mantras it says, Chandrama vai somo devanam annam ta paurnamasyam abhishunvanti. That means the food for the gods is going to be Chandrama, the moon. They approach him on full moon. This is what it says. But Yaska says, the Adidaiva meaning, Somam yam brahmana viduhu chandramasam na tasya ashnati kashchana devaiti. Please understand, he says in the Adidaiva meaning, true, Soma is Chandra, but nobody eats him literally. That is what he says. Then what it is, Soma rupa visheshaihi oshadihi chandramava. So in the Adiyajna meaning, he is the oshadi, that is a creeper which has to be pounded and made in the Soma Yaga. So the Advaryus and the priests would drink the juice of that Soma Lata. But in the Adidaiva, he is the Chandrama, that is the moon whom we can see even today. Then what happens in the Adhyatma, that is in the Upanishads? He is the Manas in the Upanishads. So Adhyatma meaning for Soma is Manas or the mind. So these are the three meanings, and we have to concentrate to get the astronomy in the Vedas on the Adidaiva meaning. Now, I will have no time to discuss all the things, so I will just briefly go through the first legend. That is the legend of Dhruva, the child who became the pole star. All of you would have known this story, so I need not repeat it. So Dhruva, the son of Uttanapada and son of Queen Suniti, he has a problem with his stepmother and his sibling, stepbrother. So he is advised to go to the forest to do worship or do tapas. And then eventually he becomes the pole star. So that he becomes Dhruva is fixed. So Uttanapada, son of Uttanapada, he becomes fixed. This is the story. All of you would have heard this, and even now, many mothers in this country, many grandmothers, they tell this story to their grandchildren. Now, you come to the astronomical information. You look at the sky and say, okay, this is the pole star. You may be showing this to your children and younger brothers and others also. But astronomy says the pole star became the pole star only in 1500 AD. That's about 500 years back. Well, then what was the situation? So how did the Puranas, Vedic texts belonging to a previous period know about a fixed star at the pole? This is the fundamental question. I hope you, all of you, follow this. If you simply assume whatever is given as Dhruva, and today's Dhruva is valid for infinite past, that would be wrong historically. And scientifically, science clearly says there was no pole star fixed before 1500 AD. Before that, the star was approaching. And if you take any text on simple astronomy, even Wikipedia or Google search, will tell you this, how to locate the pole star. Today's pole star is here. You go to the Big Dipper, or what we call the Saptarshi, the last two stars, you draw a straight line, you can get the pole, you can look at the pole star. All of us in the northern hemisphere can see this star in a clear sky. Those who are in still northern latitude, let us say Delhi or some other place, would be better place than me in Bangalore if I have to see this. But this is actually the second slide. The figure which I'm showing here is the official star chart from the International Astronomical Union. And you can see the Ursa Minor, and this is the present day pole star at the pole. The pole is, you please understand, is the north celestial pole. That is, the people on the earth, when they look at in the northern direction, if there is any star which is fixed, fixed means it will rotate in the night from 6 o'clock to early morning, 6 o'clock you can see, it doesn't set. Whereas any other star is going to set and then next day you have to again see that. Whereas this star will only rotate around, whereas the Dhruva will be fixed there. So the other stars are called the circumpolar stars. They go around like this, whereas this will be fixed here. Now, this anomaly, how are we going to sort out? Our texts all say there was Dhruva, and we all believe that we had the story of Dhruva we have heard, and he became the pole star, and Puranas say there's so many things about pole star, even the Dhruva can change also, it says. What is the meaning of this? In fact, whenever there is a contradiction, you can understand there is going to be something very wonderful or historically important information. I'm just showing through Google search, whatever you get this. This is what is called the polar circle. So this is the ecliptic pole. And the north celestial pole, what we actually see when I look at the sky is this. Today I am seeing in the north this star, that is Polaris in 2000 AD. Now, in the past, along this circle, what were the other stars, which were the pole stars would be the question. You come around this, you see that in 3000 BC there was a star which today we call it Thuban. In between there was no pole star at all, bright star, which you can take it as a pole star. Please understand, a pole star has to be fixed. That means it has to lie in the circle very closely with about an error of 4 minutes, 5 minutes, that's all. That is because the human eye can mistake even up to a degree as fixed. Whereas larger than that, it won't be fixed, it will be rotating. It will keep on making a circle. So this you please bear in mind. Now I am showing on the left side, because the 3000 BC, what is the physical artifact we are having? This is the pyramid. The pyramid of Egypt, it is said that tombs you are having, they are aligned in the direction of the pole star of those days, that is about Thuban. I will not go into that. Now, what is the other artifact in this country we are having? When I come to, say, 2500 BC or 3000 BC, it's going to be the Indus cities, because Dholavira was a flourishing city in 2500 BC. There are evidences for that. So the Indus Valley cities, Dholavira, Mohenjo-daro, Harappa, they were all flourishing in this period. But then, what are the other information that we are having? We have no other information in our country other than our texts. Now, I am showing you a video of the precession. What is meant by precession? You see, this is the earth. This is the ecliptic. This is the sun, which is like this. Earth goes round on its own axis as well as it rotates. We know that. And this is actually the Zodiac, which is there. SGR means Sagittarius, the various signs. Now let me run this. You please see anybody standing here, his north is this. Whereas the celeste, the ecliptic pole is the central point of this ellipse. You project it vertically. So there is a difference. The two are inclined at 23.5 degrees. You know that. Now let us see what happens to this. The circle, the celestial circle is the green one, and you know the ecliptic circle, the red, they intersect at the equinoctial point. 90 degrees away is this pole, and you see what happens to the person who observes the north. So it is projected now. And you get the polar circle, as I showed you previously. This was the previous diagram I was showing. Today we are here. So that moves, and full circle, it takes 26,500 years. And again it says, somewhere here was the other one. Some other ancient pole star was there. Now, how do we sort this out with reference to the Vedic text? Because the most ancient things what you are having are only the Vedas. Now, I can't go into all the details about the Vedas because it may take too much time. Briefly, we know the Rig Veda, Yajur Veda, Sama, Atharvana. There are more than about 250 texts, 200 to 250 texts, including all the ancillary texts. And all this has been transmitted orally. Please note that. These are the foundational texts for our culture, for our country, for our history, for our civilization itself. Now, somewhere, is it 5,000 years or is it 3,000 years? That question will come up. Somewhere around 300 BC, people started writing it down. And the printed versions came only around 1850 AD. So suppose I take this text, Taittiriya Aranyakam. This was printed in Mysore in 1900. Now this text is a very interesting text. This refers to stars and this gives astronomy. What should be done? It says, Smriti Pratyaksham Aitihyam Anumanas Chatushtayam Yedair Aditya Mandalam Sarvaireva Vidasyate. We have four ways that you can understand sun. One is Smriti, remembering. Pratyaksha, direct. Aitihyam, legend. Anumana, inference. So by these four ways, everybody can understand sun, it says. Now, this is how this Aranyaka text goes on, very rational. And concerning seasons, concerning stars, concerning Meru, variety of things are there. And how it describes the season, you can see. Adukhi dukkha chakshariva tedma pita iva drishyate. Shitena avyateniva rurudaksha iva drishyate. They did not know how to describe the season in the most ancient time. Today we simply say March 21st, okay, summer, spring starts, autumn starts, kind of like that. And in India we had six rutus or six seasons. But how did something start? Varsha Rutu doesn't mean on the first day there is going to be rain. We cannot say that. It shifts. So they have to understand it by social behavior. Shitena avyate niva. So he says people will get red dye. There is going to be a lot of diseases. Then you can understand that the Varsha Rutu has set in, even though the rains might not have come. Now they were highly, in other words, they were observant of the seasons, observant of the atmosphere around them, observant of what is happening around them. That is the earth, the atmosphere, and the sky. And in that, they give a very, very interesting statement. Rishayah sapta atrishchayat sarve atrayo agastyascha. That means saptarshi, you know the saptarshis. Then Atri is also a rishi in the sky. And what happened to them? And also Agastya. What is interesting about them? Nakshatre Shankruto Avasan. They are today living with the stars. That is the announcement of Taittiriya Aranyaka. The Bhashya also says the same thing. That is Sayana Bhashya also. So when we say Saptarshi Mandala or the Ursa Major, the concept was the Saptarshis, after their sojourn on earth, they are stationed in the sky as stars. In other words, you can take them as regent deities, that doesn't matter, but still there is a one-to-one correlation. And Agastya is the most important thing for astronomy. You will see why it is so. And Agastya is star Canopus. He is in the south. And Vedic Agastya is both a sage and a star. Very interesting thing as per modern astronomy about Agastya is that Agastya even today is not visible for people who are living north of 37 degrees. It can be seen only by people 34 degrees north. That is within India, in Kashmir, in Pakistan, even Damascus, Syria, people can see. But Rome and Italy, it cannot be seen. In Athens and Greece, even today, Canopus cannot be seen because it's a southern hemisphere star. And this has been worked out very neatly by several people. I will show you on that. And in India, in the Kurukshetra region, Canopus or Agastya would have been visible somewhere around 5000 BC, 4000 to 5000 BC, the star. So if a legend had to be developed between the southern star and some of the Vedic mantras, it could have happened somewhere around that time. That is, I cannot say 5000 BC, it may be 4000, it may be slightly later. Now this, in fact, comes out very beautifully in a text called Parashara. Parashara Tantra says, Hastaste Savitir Yudeti. Because this Canopus, as we saw, already I showed you from Taittira Aranyaka, he is with the star, he is in the sky. Because he is a Vedic sage, he is a Vedic mantra drashtara in the Rig Veda, very, very important rishi. And you know that he is also one of the Gotra Pravartaka. Now all the the Hindus who trace their lineage to the Vedas accept they belong to a Gotra. What are these Gotras? There are only 7 rishis: Atri, Bhrigu, Kutsa, Vasishta, Gautama, Kashyapa, Angirasa, Agastyo Ashtamaha. The 8th is Agastya. These are the only 8 people who started our culture in this country. So all Hindus have to trace their lineage only to this 8. So Parashara says he will be visible along with star Hasta in the east, because they wanted to know when he rises. As you would have seen, he is visible only for 3 months in a year. Whereas Saptarshis are visible all through the year. Agastya is not visible all through the year, being a southern star. So you can see that in Kurukshetra, in minus 3000, he would not have been visible at all in the morning times. Evening times also not visible. But in Pushkara, he would be visible. That is slightly below, that is Ajmer, he would have been visible in 3000. So it's very sensitive to the position. So people in north, they could have seen, I don't deny that, the Vedic people. But not in Kurukshetra, not in Jammu Kashmir, but in Rajasthan they would have seen. And you come, if you go to a later year, then even in Kurukshetra they would have seen. Today, of course, even up to Kashmir and other places you can see. So over thousands of years, the change has taken place and the dates are also given here. So who was visible in October, now he is visible already in September. Even in August, he would be visible in some places. In South India, he would be visible even from 10,000 BC. Because, you are going nearer and nearer to the equator. Now, this information, why it is important? It is important for our chronology. So, I can clearly say now, if somebody argues that, Aryans came into India in 1500 BC and all this started, blah, blah. Look, that is wrong. Because our own text, the same Vedic text says, Agastya was visible, he was with the star, he had become a star when it was possible for the Vedic people, somewhere around 3000 BC. That is what you have to say. Now, this is not all. There is a more beautiful thing in the Taittiriya Aranyaka. That is what is called the Swadhyaya Brahmana. This mantra I am showing. Prapadye Brahma Prapadye Brahma Kosham Prapadye Amartam Prapadye Amarta Kosham Prapadye. It starts like that. Then Brahmana Varmanaham Tejasa Kashyapasiti. I will not translate that, all of that. You can read it. But the next one is most important. The Vyakhyana of Sayana says, Brahma Upasthana Kale Sarvatmakasya Parameshwarasya Shishumarakya Jalagraha Rupatvam Dhyanartam Darshayati. Is the Parameshwara, that is the Paramatma, who is in the form of Shishumara, a whale or a porpoise, or you can imagine even as any kind of jalachara. What is that mantra? Yasmai namah tachiro dharmo murdanam brahma uttarahanuhu yajno adara vishnu hridayam samvatsara prajananam. It goes like this. I will not read it. Then complete descriptions are given. I will show you the next one. Sava yesha divya shakvaraha shishumaraha. Now, you see, Sayana already said, you have to meditate on the Paramatma in the evening, Brahma Upasthana Kala. That is when Gayatri Upasthana, Sandhyopasana, you turn north and do this mantra. And what is that mantra? He gives the part of that Shishumara. where head, what is in the head, what is in the tail, what is in the center, what is the name of that, and finally, what is that? Dhruvastvamasi, dhruvasya kshitamasi, tvam bhutanam adhipitirasi, tvam bhutanam shreshtosi, tvam bhutani upaparyavartante, namaste namaha, sarvante namo namaha, shishu kumaraya namaha. It also comes as shishu maraya namaha. This is the Krishna Yajurvediya Taittira Aranyake Dvitiya Prapataka Ekona Vimshati Anuvaka. People say even this, even now. But what is this meditation that is suggesting? That we have to see. It is here. There are 14 stars. Starting with the head is called Dharma, the shiras Murdanam, then Brahma Uttarahanuhu. In the various parts. The Dharma is head, Uttanapada is the upper jaw, Kratu is the lower jaw, and then Vishnur Hridayam, you please remember this. Vishnur Hridayam, this mantra, this comes up late, very late. I have to refer to that towards the end also. Then these are the names which come in the Puranas. I have listed here 14 names in the Purana. Exactly the same name except for one of them. That should not matter. And this is actually to make a murti, a dhyana. Like, you know, we say you have to worship Vishnu, you have Shankha, you have the chakra, then four arms and all that. In the same way, Shishumara, how it is. This was the kind of picture which is in the Veda itself. That is in the sky. They have to look at the sky, also meditate on this form. Now, this is very interesting. This is what is called Dhruva. The last star is what is called Dhruva. There are 14 stars, and the last star is called Dhruva. This is a constellation because the mantra itself says Divya Shakwaraha Shishumaraha. It is the Divya Shakwara, is an animal which is in the sky, it's the celestial sky. Saina and others have all accepted this fully. There is no question on that. I just put the same thing in English translation. I will skip this. Now, today, if you see the sky, you take any planetarium software and see that, they will show an animal like this. After this Ursa Major, that is the bear, as it is called, what we also called in ancient times, Riksha, that is bear only. Today, we call them Saptarshi, the seven stars. The next mandala is going to be this called the dragon or the Draco. This Draco has 14 prominent stars. The same thing I have shown here. This is the present day picture. Now, removing the animals, I am showing here the modern picture, 2000 AD picture. And I am also showing a 2830 BC picture. Please see this. Now, this is the celestial pole. What we can see at the north. Today. Now, where is the 14 stars? We don't see that Vedic picture here very clearly. So, I will show you another one. Once again, I will come to this. This is the Vedic picture. If you can see my thing that I am showing here. This is the Vedic picture. I will show you a bigger picture. But in 2800, how this would have seen, because of precision, this is how it would have. This is the Dharma, this is the Uttanapada, this would be the Vishnu, this is Uttarapadav, the two twins, Ashwina Uttarapadav, Maitra Varanam Aparapadav, and then Dhruvaha Puccha. Puccha, that is in the tile, would have been Dhruva, fixed here. Because this may rotate, but this point will seem fixed from the earth. Now, this is a better picture what I am showing. And what the film I showed you already, this is the precession, the phenomenon of precession. 27,000 years to complete one cycle. And this is the Vedic Dhruva here on the polar circle. And Sadhya or Vishnu, you have to identify somewhere here in this region. These are the 14 bright stars. You can count 1, 2, 3, 4. 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, up to 14 here. There are names also given for this. You can plot, instead of the dragon, a porpoise, a whale on this one. That is the Shishumara. And today that is called Alpha Draconis, the star, or Thuban. This was possible only in 3000 BC. So if the message is, if the Taittiriya Aranyaka people knew, they mentioned this as Dhruva, as fixed, they would have seen this constellation, whoever they were, Krishna Yajurvedi people, wherever they were living, they would have seen this only around 3000 BC. And the mantra could have been composed, or the mantra Drashtara could have seen this only in 3000 BC, not anything later. Because at any later period, there was no pole star. Now you may question, this becomes historically more interesting. Look, this is 3000 BC. I am here in 2000 AD. What happened in between to our country? What happened to the Vedas in between? If I claim that, Vedic people knew this and this is how it is. Do the Vedas or other texts say something on this? Did they forget this? Or did they superpose the modern Dhruva and the older Dhruva? What is happening? This is the cultural history, and as Indians, we have to understand this carefully, because ours is the only culture which has two pole stars, whereas anybody else has only one pole star, if at all they are having. Whereas we have two pole stars in our text, in the Sanskrit text, I am telling. Now, where is the movement of the Dhruva coming in? Because from 3000 BC, you come to 2000 BC, Dhruva would not be there. 1000 years, it would have moved. There would be no pole star around 2000 BC or 1500 BC. There is another Maitrayaniya Aranyaka of the Yajurveda. The Yajurveda text, this is again an accented text available. It says, Sarvam Chedam Krishna Pashyamo Yatho Me Damsha Mashakadeha. This is King Brihadrata, who is asking the Muni Shakyayana for Upadesha. So when he goes to his Brahmopadesha to understand what is life, he puts these questions. Everything is transient. Now, because he's in Upanishad, people have ignored the first Prapataka. It's very wrong. This is the Prathama Prapataka, the most important Prapataka for a person like me or anyone who is interested in the history of this country. Because here, the questions are very interesting. What are the questions? Kimetaihi arvarnyanam shoshanam. Why the seas get dried up? Shikarinam prapatanam. Why the... you can understand the Sanskrit very easily. Why the hills, you know, the tops are falling down. More than that, why? Dhruvasya pravachalanam. Even Dhruva is moving. Why is that? And then what happens? Vatarajunam nimajjanam. Vrashchanam vatarajunam. Vatarajju are the strings which are supposed to be related from Dhruva to the planets and the nakshatras, because there is a very ancient model that comes in the Brahmanda Purana, not in the Veda. Vedas have very cryptic statements about it. They are all dipping, because you know, once it moves to some other part, you can see, you imagine a globe, and you know, it tilts like this, everything has to dip. And what is happening? Prithivyaha sthanad apasarana, the earth which he thought it was fixed, it has moved. He understands that. How did he move that? Because the Dhruva, they were aligning it with some position, maybe a tree or a hill or whatever. And Dhruva was not aligned with that hill anymore. That is their Dhruva. That was Thuban. What they knew as in the 3000 BC, what was the star? Because the Brahmopasana was done with reference to that. That was not there. So that is his trouble. And this is a very serious thing. And this is the effect of precision. Now, people would say that the Greeks found out the precision and the understanding developed only around 400 BC or so. That is all untrue. Now, the reason might not be known. The reason was not known till even modern times. Only when we knew the heliocentric theory and the rotation of the earth, people understood this. But the effect will be that. The reason may not be known. The reason for an explanation may not be known, but we will be knowing the effect. So this is what is happening. Now, how do I date then Maitrayaniya Aranyaka? Can I say it was 2000 BC? Fortunately, there is some information in the Maitrayaniya Aranyakam which says the seasons start with Shravishtardham Agneyam Kramena Utkramena Sarpadyam Shravishtardantam Saumyam. Literally, what it means is they want to understand time. The most important thing for them was time. That is even in the Vedic period and even now. Even in modern physics, it is time and space that has to be understood. True, even in philosophy. what this Aranyaka say? Kalas, Suryo Yonirvai Kalasya. It is the Surya is the origin of all Kala. Tasi etad rupam yan nimeshadi kala samratam. But there are two kinds of time. One is the Murta and the other one is the Amurta. One we can understand, measure. Other one, it is simply continuously flowing. What is that you can understand? That you can do only with reference to the sun. And when sun is in the half of Dhanishta Nakshatra, the Uttarayana starts. Uttarayana is the winter solstice. Now from today's astronomy, we know that the winter solstice, when it started in half of Dhanishta, was something around 1800 BC. So we know that in 1800 BC, Maitraya Aranyaka approximately, the king Brihadrata saw that the original Dhruva was not in the original position. Dhruva, the name Dhruva was there, but he was not in his fixed position. He had moved, even he had moved. That was his trouble. I will not go into the Upanishad further. But later on, what happens from 1800 BC onwards, Brahmanda Purana, one of the beautiful Puranas, which is highly scientific, gives in about 300 verses. If you people are interested, you should read this Purana. Very simple. He says, Bhuta Sammohanam Hetat Nibodhame Pratyakshamapi Darshyancha Sammoheti Yat Prajaha Yoyam Chaturdisham Puche Shaishumare Vivastitaha Uttana Pada Putrosa Medi Bhuto Dhruvo Divi Savai Brahmayate Nityam Chandra Dityo Grahaisaha Brahmanta Manugachanti Nakshatranicha Chakravati. He says he is rotating. Dhruva, who is the son of Uttanapada, he is in the north, all right. He uses the same name, Dhruva, but he is rotating. Where? Rotating in the same place, he says. And he rotates, even the sun, moon, all the stars also, he makes them rotate in his own way. And he gives several meanings for this, several examples, how he is moving. He moves like, he says, I will show you the figure later on, like the potter's wheel. You know the potter's wheel? He gives several models. Sudarshan, you have to remind me about the time. Okay?
Sir, 10 more minutes for 10 o'clock.
Oh my God, I think I have to rush through that. Then I have to wind up? Okay. So this is the Tilapeta, the oil model he gives. And there are so many shlokas, we'll skip them. These are the models which are given. So the Dhruva is sitting here, he says. And a better model is this. So it's a planetary model. Before the Siddhantic astronomy was this model. This is the Dhruva. This is the Meru or the Medi. And this is the bullock was the planets. The planets were like the bullocks. So Dhruva would rotate them in circles. This was the model which is given. Now, after Thuban left the pole, once again, the same drawing I'm showing. See, 3000 BC, Abhaya was there. And the Puranas also say, Suniti, his mother got a vara, boon from Brahma, that she will also remain with her son in the sky, along with her son. That is Abhaya Dhruva, this is Suniti. There is actually a star very near this Thuban even now. You can easily see that in any of the planetarium. So this is the picture which was there in the Vedic period. And you can identify the stars. This is Prajapati. This is Indra. This is Agni. This is going to be the other, there are the other stars. Now, there are several other texts which talk about this. Mahabharata. Dhruva Prajolito Goram Apasavyam Pravarta. It says during the war, Dhruva was going. Dhruva was moving. How can Dhruva move if he is fixed? Simply precision. They had observed the precision was happening. And also you would be curious to know that the Draupadi Swayamvara was held in a town called Shishumarapura. So the name of the town that Drupada builds a new town called Shishumarapura. Why it is called Shishumara? That was Praguttarena Nagarad. It was in the northeastern part of the city, of his city. So the Shishumara, the celestial Shishumara was very, very sacred for the ancient Indians. He had moved to the northeast, so he wanted the marriage also to be conducted in the northeast because the Dhruva had to be seen. I will skip the legend of Nahusha. And this Shishumara is mentioned in several other texts. For example, Panchavimsha Brahmana also says there are Jain texts, Bhadrabahu Samhita of 300 BC. They also know Shishumara. They don't know Dhruva because Dhruva had moved. But a very peculiar thing happens. There are many texts which refer to Dhruva, like these are in the manuscript form, the Vridhagarga Samhita. There are other texts which refer only to Shishumara, but not the Dhruva. Now, Bhagavata also changes the story a little bit, even though Dhruva and other things are there. And later on, all this became a big controversy. The controversy was the following. Al-Biruni actually mentions that the Hindus know a constellation called Shishumara, and they say there are pole stars in Shishumara. And he was in the 11th century, and he laughs. They have mistaken the fish for the Shishumara. The Hindus tell rather ludicrous tales when speaking of the figure in which they represent the stars, etc., etc. He thinks the Hindus who he knew, they were all wrong in telling their pole stars in Shishumara. But he understood that Shishumara is same as the Persian Susmar. And so he said, they are thinking that it should have been in what Persians call the lizard. That is the modern Draco. He understood that. And he also says the same thing in his translation of the Yoga Sutra also. Because it's very important. The Sutra 3.29 is Dhruve Tadgati Jnanam. This is Yoga Sutra. Dhruve Tadgati Jnanam means whose gati? The Bhashya say it is the gati of the stars and the moon and all that. No. Tadgati is Tasya Gati Dhruvasya Gati. That is the correct interpretation. Then you know everything will be all right, because by the time the Yoga Sutra was formed, the Dhruva was moving, and if you concentrate on Dhruva, you will know how he is moving. That is the meaning of this. Now, this concept has come to the modern time, and the most important thing is our Siddhantic astronomers, they never touched Shishumara. They knew Shishumara. They also knew another star constellation called Dhruva Matsya. This was nearing the North Pole. They called it Matsya, a fish. And the Dhruva was placed in the mouth of the fish, not in the tail of the fish. But then, at the same time, there are famous philosophers in our country, Shankara, Ramanuja, later on Madhva. They were the Vedic people who were carrying on the Vedic tradition. What do they say? Shankaracharya in the Vishnu Sahasranama, in his Bhashya, he writes that Dhruvasya, I am quoting here, Shishumara Varnane Vishnu Hridayam Iti Taittira Aranyakam. So the Dhruva is going to be the one which is said in the Taittira Aranyakam. And the commentary on that also says very clearly, it is going to be something like Sarata Godakriti Akaraha Tadakritis Jyotish Chakram. So the translation is here. So Shankaracharya in 800 AD, he referred to this, and they knew it only as going to be in the 14 stars, not in the Dhruva Matsya near the present day North Pole. Same thing in the Parashara Bhattar in the Sri Vaishnava tradition. They also quote the same thing. There is no difference of opinion. Same thing in the Madhva tradition also. This continued in our marriage tradition, Hindu marriage tradition also. Don't ask me, the priest, which star they show today. I don't know that. But the mantras are same, whatever was done during the Vedic period. And this led to a controversy among the Indologists about 120 years back. But these people did not know Taittiriya Aranyaka. They all argued based on hearsay and only Grihya Sutras. Grihya Sutras were late, 500 BC. So he said in 500 BC also there was no pole star. So why did they say about Dhruva? So it should have been a older one, was the argument of Jacobi. He was correct, but he could not give the evidence of Taittiriya Aranyaka. This Whitney and Keith, they were all opinionated people. They also did not refer to this. They also went on arguing this. But in any case, we know that this was the only possibility. And the Yajurvedic Vedic texts, more ancient than the sutras, do contain reference to Shishumara constellation carrying the pole star. And the present day mantra which is used is in the Ekagni Kanda, which is also a Vedic text. That mantra is the Dhruva Kshitihi Dhruva Yoni Dhruvamasi Dhruvastitam Tvam Nakshatrana Metyasi. So he is the center point of all the stars. So you can understand. So if you worship the present day Dhruva, okay, there may be nothing wrong with reference to the meaning of this. But if you are culturally interested, historically, the old star was going to be the Thuban, which was there in 3000 BC. Now, this word Shishumara comes in Rigveda. I will skip this. So I have come to my conclusion. So the current Dhruva is here 2000. Dhruva of the Krishna Yajurveda was about 2800, say 3000. It would be very close. Maitreya, Arannika, Puranas, Mahabharata refer to the star as moving. So the precession effect was felt definitely in our country also. I've given some details. Let me skip this. So roughly a chronology can be worked out. But we are not interested in this, in this talk at least. So this is actually the Vaidika Jyotisham or Vaidika astronomy or Vedic astronomy. So it is a natural observation of the sky and a classification, a scientific observation, classification, generalization, numbering, counting, pattern recognition. All this is there in the Veda in their own way. This leads to some very interesting information on eclipses, stars, and chronology also. So I will not read the summary and conclusion. So there are, you can see there are two pole stars. One is the Vedic Dhruva. This is the Vedic Dhruva is worshipped in this forum even today in many of the temples in Karnataka. Particularly people who belong to the Madhva Sampradaya, they know that even in their houses is worshipped. This is actually a metallic icon. And this, you can see the form of Vishnu, which is like a whale. It's not a fish, it is a whale. And Dhruva is sitting at the time. The Puranic Dhruva is this, what all we know, what we have heard from our grandmothers and in some of the storybooks, Amar Chitrakata, this is the Dhruva. Both are very important. And this Dhruva can be seen even today here. Whereas this Dhruva we can see only in the Vedic texts and by meditation. So our culture had two Dhruvas and this is the most important message I want to give you today. Thank you so much. Any questions, if there is time, I'll be happy.
Please raise your hand and you may ask questions. I saw that Harish had a question. Harish, do you want to say something?
Yes, you're able to hear me?
Yes, go ahead.
Yes, sir. Thanks a lot for this lecture. I think it was a realization for me as well. For example, I have been chanting this Dhruva Nakshatra Upasthanam for a very, very long time. And my son has also been doing it since Upanayanam. But only today we realized that we are actually praying to this Thuban, which you refer to, and not to the pole star. Although we did do a visual, I actually showed my son where exactly is the pole star and why we are facing north while doing this. But looks like that is not the actual Dhruva that we are praying to with this mantra. Am I correct?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So is this Thuban, it's not visible at all? We can't even see it in any part of the world now?
No, Thuban can be seen. You can easily see that.
Okay.
In the planetarium, you can easily see, or even on stellarium on your web, you can see that. Particularly in some time you can see. You have to go a little bit north and if there is not many bright lights nearby, you can see it is dim. The magnitude is rather dim. So you have to make an effort, you can definitely see. Yeah, why not?
Okay, so in stellarium, when I put pole star, that means I'm seeing the Puranic Dhruva. Is that right?
Correct. Puranic means it is not exactly Puranic. What you are seeing is the 1500 AD pole star. Okay. That is what our Siddhantic astronomers said about Dhruva Matsya. Uh-huh. So, whereas you put Thuban on stellarium, it will search and show you.
Okay.
You type in if you have access to that Thuban, Thuban.
Okay. I have access to stellarium. I will do that.
Yeah. You can easily see that.
The other interesting part of that Aranyaka mantra, although we have not been chanting it from a Dhruva perspective, but more importantly, it tells you that you cannot attain death in air or in water or in fire. So there are verses which come later there, which we chant along with that mantra as such. So that's the other interesting part of that mantra.
Mm-hmm. 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 Yeah, maybe, yeah. I haven't gone into the other issues, you know, the esoteric issues. I'm sticking only to the astronomical issues.
Yes, sir, I understand.
So what you have to follow here is this is not Vedanga Jyotisha. Vedanga Jyotisha came later, which is part of Veda, all right, but are the ancillary texts. What I'm showing you here is Vedic Jyotisha itself. That is the hardcore Jyotisha, which is in the Vedas themselves. That is all the difference you have to see.
Okay.
So, Professor Aranai Sudarshan here. So, the days of the week came later, right? The Rashis came later. Is that correct?
Yeah, yeah, that is true. No, the word Rashi has been there, but you know, the weekdays came later, all of the late, that is true. That is in the common era, that is about around 100 AD or so. That is true.
So, is it true that it came from the Yavana Jataka and the Romaka Jataka?
Which one you are referring to?
The days of the week.
No, 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 no. Days of the week, nobody knows from where it has come. Even in the Western historical text, there is no way of knowing where it originated. Maybe Babylonians had originated. Maybe in our own country it originated. I have no idea. Very hard to say about the weekdays. Because Bharatanatya Shastra also doesn't have weekdays. Kautilya's Arthashastra doesn't have weekdays. For auspiciousness, I am telling. So they will see only the Shubha Nakshatra, Tithi Karana, Muhurta, Velayam. That's all. No Vara. So it has come later. Yeah, that is true.
And what was the origin of, I know it is outside the scope, but I was also curious, if this is the case, then when did Phala Jyotisha enter India?
Which one?
Phala Jyotisham.
Phala Jyotisham. Oh.
The astrology, the omens and all that.
No, no, no. You see, there is a kind of astrology in this country already from 1500 BC. That is the omens. The astrology was with reference to the sky. And the Janma Nakshatra. In fact, in Parashara Tantra, it is discussed. In my book, I have extensively translated that part. What one would call the, what is called the Nakshatra Jataka, depending on the star in which a person was born. What has come into the country, which was tagged on to the original Jyotisha, was horoscope. Horoscopes were not there. That is a later concept. Whereas originally it was the 27 stars. With reference to the stars, they did every work. Even in the Vedic period. So there was some effect associated with the stars and the human beings. That was very clear. So that kind of astrology is not new to India. It is there from the Vedic period. But not this horoscope. That is what I want to convey.
Sir Harish here, one more question. So is calculating eclipses, when they occur, etc. So for that, we still require the mathematical astronomy, or we can also have something from the Vedic astronomy for that?
Very good question. I think I will have to give a talk on that some other time, because we have to know the Vedic number. That is that number I showed you, the number of Vishvadevas and the Vishvadevas drinking Soma of Moon. So there is going to be an 18-year cycle out of that. And if that 18-year cycle is properly understood, I think with reference to that, one will be able to estimate when the next lunar eclipse. I can't say about solar. Lunar eclipse is possible. We can work it out even now. I have written on that. Maybe if there is interest, I can give a talk at some other.
Okay,
and also knew about the 6-monthly eclipses, but calculation was the important thing, because after all, as human beings, we all want to forecast, predict in advance, much in advance. You know, so that is how mathematics started. So either way, it is a tricky question what you have asked, but I think they had some of the eclipses they were able to predict, some perhaps not.
Okay.
Professor, I am reading a typed question by another one of the participants, Amit Latkar from the Supreme Court in Delhi. He says, he's asking if the legend of Lord Shiva ordering Agastya to cross Vindhyas and go south is that connected with Canopus?
Is it?
Connected with the Canopus.
Oh, it is. It is connected with the Canopus. You see, it is quite possible that some people might have emigrated from the north to the south. That is clear. But the allegory, as I see, is there is a correlation with Canopus because Agastya was not visible. He was below the Vindhyas for people who were north of Vindhyas. And then he was visible above the Vindhya. You understand that? So in the period when I showed you, say 2900 BC, somewhere in Pushkara, the people who were in Ajmer, they were thinking that this is Agastya who has gone to the south, crossing the Vindhyas. That means you have a model, a physical model, which inverts the celestial observation. The celestial observation is inverted, and you say that from the north he has gone to the south. Actually, in the south, the star goes up because of the precession of the equinoxes. So that star came up and was visible in Ajmer. And they were very clear that they wanted to observe. And you know, why I am stressing on this point is that in the beginning of the talk, I mentioned about the evidences that are available for the period 3rd millennium BC. The physical artifacts are all only from the Indus cities. All the other artifacts or the other evidences are only textual evidence. But the two match. Now, how do you relate these two? So even in the Indus region, they would have seen Agastya very clearly. And Agastya, you remember, he drank the ocean. And then only the ocean dried up. And then after that, he went to the south. Crossed the Vindhyas and went to the south to do the tapas and all that. So the question of Mr. Latkar is correct. So we can relate it like that.
And any theory, astronomical theory about drinking of the ocean?
Astronomical theory is not there. But the ocean dried up, we know that. You know, the run of Kutch was a sea. Now it is dried up.
Okay.
If you have visited the Dholavira, it was about 8 hours from Ahmedabad. You can go and see the run of Kutch. Run of Kutch is fully of only salt and other things. In the rainy season, there is going to be 3 inches water there. Otherwise, you know that you can see that it is an ocean, or it was an ocean. That ocean got dried up. That happened around 3000 BC. Slowly it dried up. Coeval with Saraswati drying up. So this takes us to another question, Sudarshan, which we have to discuss in very great length. The history becomes more and more interesting, connects with geography. History and geography cannot be separated out. So Saraswati we have to understand. And Saraswati River drying up, connected with the run of Kutch, that drying up, what was the role of Agastya in that, what is the role of Sagara in that, so many issues. Interesting.
And you did mention in one of the other lectures that the run of Kutch, the modern name, is cognate with the Vedic name Irina.
Oh, yeah. you are dragging me into a conversation. I don't mind talking, but you are right. Irina was the original name for run of Kutch that became dried up. True. That is Irina. So in Rigveda, the name is mentioned, word is mentioned 6 times. Mahabharata also Irina comes up. And it says in the Mahabharata, the Saraswati went from the Irina, left the Irina, because Irina was a cursed place. That is connected with the Yajurveda mantra, which you may be knowing, that, you know, the Trishira. Trishika, he had 3 heads, which Indra cuts the 3 heads. One of the heads falls in Irina. So Irinam Sanjatam, that is why Shraddha Devyaha, some mantra is there. Irinena Vyase. So the orthodox people, Ahitagni Shraddha Devyaha, Irinena Vyase. They should not stay in Irina, Ahitagni. So there is an emigration from Run of Kutch region of orthodox people going towards Kurukshetra. They emigrated out of that place. It's again a historical information contained in the Vedic text. So that's all very, yeah.
Professor, namaskaram, Professor. This is Soundar Rajan here. I'm curious to know if you are formally trained in astronomy in any way, or how did you acquire such knowledge about astronomy?
Well, I'm basically a civil engineer. So in my student days, we were taught, of course, trigonometrical surveying, which is nothing but astronomical surveying. So, and what is astronomy? It is only trigonometry, you know, spherical trigonometry, at least the kind of astronomy I am talking about. I am not an astrophysicist, let me say, and I am not a positional astronomer in the modern sense, but I'm not afraid of that. So the question is, naked eye observations, how they have to be interpreted is the meaning. In other words, our ancient people, they did only naked eye observations. So today, if I had to do naked eye observation, what conclusions I can come to? How do you interpret it? That is what is called archaeoastronomy. So you can call me an archaeoastronomer if you want, but I am not a professional astronomer in that sense. You are right.
I just have one more question about lunar eclipse. I think the legend is that Rahu and Ketu are swallowing the moon or something like that.
No.
Instead of just one other entity, they were talking about two entities swallowing the moon. Do you have any explanation for why they would believe that, or I am wrong in thinking that?
Well, your statement is correct. That is how modern people, many people, even the books it is written. But that is all wrong. The ancient people did not take it that way at all. There is no evidence for that in the Veda. Rahu came up much later. He is mentioned only in the Atharvana Veda. Ketu was always the comets. Ketu was not the descending lunar node as it is today. Even in the Maitra and Aranyaka. If you want more on that, you have to read my Parashara Tantra book. I have discussed this in great length. There has been a great disservice done to Vedic texts mentioning that Ketu is the descending lunar node. What happens is, we know that the orbital astronomy, that is understanding of the lunar orbit, cuts the ecliptic in two points, the north and the south, started only after orbital astronomy started. That is when the Siddhantic astronomy period. Maybe 100 years this way, that way. Now in Maitrayana Aranyaka, there is mention of Rahu and Ketu. If you refer to Rahu and Ketu as the ascending and descending lunar nodes, that means the Vedic text should belong to 100 AD or 200 AD. That's what some people have written because they have interpreted Ketu wrongly. It is a great disservice to our history. Ketu was always the comet, not the descending one. Only later, Palajyotisha people, somewhere around 1300, 1400 AD onwards, they imposed that Ketu is another graha which will create a Chandra Grahana and things like that. It was not there. Even in Mahabharata, it is not. It is always Rahu. Rahu is the only graha who can cause both solar and lunar eclipse. You have to see this. This is a very serious question that needs a lot of study into the ancient texts. Even Kalidasa mentions only Rahu. It doesn't talk about Ketu at all when it comes to eclipses. Ramayana does not mention, Mahabharata does not mention. I think somewhere we have missed the bus. The reason are, again, horoscopes. We will not go into that right now.
If there are no more questions, we can end this session. Anybody else? Professor, it was great listening to you. It has created so many curiosities, and I will personally be in touch with you. And for the others, Professor, is there an email ID that anybody can write to you if they have anything?
I showed in the beginning. They can note it down. If somebody is interested. It is rn.iyengar@jainuniversity.ac.in. Okay.
All right. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you. Bye. Good night. Shubha Ratri.